Welcome to the next free video of the 7640 Active Directory course. This video looks at domain functional levels. The domain functional level determines which features you can use in your domains. The higher the domain function level, the more Active Directory features there are. However, there is a catch. In order to go to a higher functional level, you must have only domain controllers of that functional level or higher in your domain. For example, if your domain functional level is Windows Server 2003, you will not be able to use any domain controllers of Windows Server 2000. The domain functional level only applies to domain controllers. Regardless of the domain functional level, you can have any client or server operating system join your domain. For example, you could have a Windows 2000 computer join the domain even if you are running the currently highest functional level of Windows Server 2008 R2. You could also join other operating systems like Mac or Linux to the domain. The functional level only applies to the domain controllers. The first domain functional level that I want to look at is Windows 2000 Native. Windows 2000 Native is the lowest domain functional level that Windows Server 2008 R2 supports. In order to raise your domain functional level to Windows Server 2000 Native, you must remove all domain controllers from your network that are running Windows NT 4. Since Windows Server 2000 Native is the lowest domain functional level that Windows Server 2008 R2 supports, this is why you cannot have Windows NT 4 domain controllers on your network. If you select Windows 2000 Native, you basically get Active Directory. There are no special features at this domain functional level that are worth mentioning. The next domain functional level is Windows Server 2003. When your domain is at this domain functional level, all the domain controllers in your domain must be Windows Server 2003 or above. If you attempt to add a lower level domain controller, such as Windows Server 2000 later on, the operation will fail. With the Windows Server 2003 domain functional level, you do get some new features. The first feature is the ability to rename a domain controller. Previously, you would have had to remove Active Directory from the domain controller, rename the domain controller, and then promote the server back to a domain controller. With the Windows Server 2003 domain functional level, you do not have to demote the domain controller to a server in order to rename it. The second feature adds new attributes to account directory. One new attribute is last login timestamp. This is a useful feature that allows you to determine when a user last logged on to the domain. Using this feature, you can run a query on your domain, helping you to find any users that have not logged in for a long time. With this information, you can use it to clean out some inactive users. Every object in Active Directory has attributes. To demonstrate how these work, I will quickly open ADSI Edit from Administrative Tools. This tool allows you to view and edit attributes in Active Directory. If I open the Users folder and open the properties of the administrator account, this will show all the attributes that are assigned to the administrator account. If I go down to last logon timestamp, I can see the date and time the administrator last logged in. This is only one of the attributes each user has. You can see how Active Directory can be expanded to include new attributes. Windows Server 2003 domain functional level also includes support for an additional attribute called user password. This is added to an object called inetorgperson. The inetorgperson object is a storage object for a user from a non-Active Directory system. If you use another directory service, you may want to migrate to Active Directory or use both systems together. The problem with using another directory service is the user password and other attributes. This domain functional level adds support to store a password from a third-party directory service inside the inetorgperson object. This essentially means that you can import a user and their data from another directory service into Active Directory via the INET org person object. Since this now contains a user password attribute, Active Directory can use the password in the INET org person object to log the user onto the domain. Previously, the user would have needed to have their password reset, or they would have needed to use two passwords, one for Active Directory and one for the other system. With the new user password attribute, linking other directory systems with Active Directory is a lot easier. The next feature that this domain level offers is constrained delegation. To understand what this does, you first need to understand what delegation is. Consider this example where delegation would come into play. An administrator wants to install an application on a user's computer. They send their username and password to the client's computer, which allows them access. The administrator then sends a command to the client's computer, telling the client to connect to a file server to get the installed files. In order for the client's computer to do this, it needs a username and password to access the file server. In order to protect the install files, you would want to make them available only to an administrator. This is where the problem comes in. In order for the client's computer to access the file share, it needs to pass on the administrator's credentials to the file server. When this occurs, it is called delegation. The problem with delegation is that potentially a virus on the client's computer could get the administrator's username and password and use it to access any computer on the network and then leapfrog to other computers. This is why delegation in this form is disabled by default. With the Windows Server 2003 domain functional level, you can enable delegation but restrict to which services it has access. This provides a safer way to use delegation than previously. To illustrate delegation, I will open Active Directory users and computers from the Start menu. I will navigate to the computer's OU and select the properties for one of the computer accounts. From inside Properties, select the Delegation tab. I can see the current delegation is set to off, which is the default. The next option is to trust delegation, but only when using Kerberos. Kerberos is a great security protocol, but a problem could occur if the administrator's computer was to become compromised and this computer was trusted for delegation. This computer could then be used as a stepping stone to access any computer on the network. The next option is added by the Windows Server 2003 domain functional level. This allows you to trust the computer for delegation, but to specify which services are allowed. If a hacker were to take advantage of delegation, they would be limited to the services listed, and thus the possible damage they could do is reduced. By default, Kerberos will be used, but if you need to, you can change the option to accept any valid protocol. If I now select Add, I can select the users or computers that I want this computer account to be trusted to use. If I only wanted the computer account to be trusted to read install media stored on DC1, I could select SIFS, which is the protocol used by Windows file sharing. What this means is that an administrator could send their username and password to this computer, telling it to install an application. The application install files are located on DC1. In order to access these files, DC1 will need a username and password. Since the workstation is trusted for delegation for file sharing only, and only to DC1, it can pass the administrator's username and password to DC1 to access the files. For ultimate security, you could make the file share on DC1 read-only. Thus, the only damage a hacker could do would be to read your software install media. You can see how having granular control over delegation is a lot more secure at this domain functional level. Previously, you would have had to have given the keys to the kingdom, so to speak, in order to use delegation. The next feature added is selected authentication. This feature allows you to specify the users and groups from a trusted forest who are allowed to access resources. This allows you to put more control on access when you work with multiple forests. The last feature that Windows Server 2003 Domain Functional Level adds is support to store Authorization Manager policies. Authorization Manager is a flexible framework for integrating access controls into applications. With this domain functional level, you can now store Authorization Manager policies in the Active Directory database. The next domain functional level is Windows Server 2008. You may be wondering why there is no Windows Server 2003 R2 domain functional level. The reason for this is that the installation disks for Windows Server 2003 and Windows Server 2003 R2 are identical. What is different is that when you start Windows Server 2003 R2 for the first time, you will be asked to insert Windows Server 2003 R2 Disk 2. This will allow you to add additional R2 features to Windows Server 2003 R2. If you wanted to, you could cancel the wizard and not install any additional features. The difference between 2003 and R2 is basically some additional add-on software. This is why there is no Windows Server 2003 R2 domain functional level, because there is no significant difference to the way the operating system works or to Active Directory. In order to raise your functional level to Windows Server 2008, all your domain controllers in that domain must be Windows Server 2008 or above. Windows Server 2008 domain functional level includes support for the use of DFS for replication of the sysvol share. This share contains all the group policy and login scripts for the domain. DFS is a much more efficient system of replication, so using it should save you some bandwidth. Windows Server 2008 domain functional level also supports Advanced Encryption Security, or AES, for Kerberos. The security currently used for Kerberos is quite good. However, if you want even better security, you can use AES. This comes in both 128 and 256 bits. Also added with the Windows Server 2008 domain functional level is support for last login details. With the domain functional level 2003, you have support for last logon timestamp. With Windows Server 2008, this adds support for the number of incorrect logins from that user. The next feature is fine-grained passwords. This allows you to configure different password lengths and complexity requirements for different users. Consider this example. In the past, if you had a commercial network and then a secure network, the only way a pre-Windows Server 2008 domain functional level could have had different password requirements for different users was to create a different domain. As shown here, a secure and a commercial domain needed to be created to meet this requirement. If you did not want to create an extra domain, you basically had to make a decision on which set of password requirements to use. With Windows Server 2008 domain functional level, you can combine the two domains like this. Now the secure domain is simply another organizational unit, or OU, in the same domain. With the users separated into different OUs, you can assign one set of password requirements to the commercial OU and one to the secure OU. The last domain functional level is Windows Server 2008 R2. In order to raise your domain to this functional level, all domain controllers must be running Windows Server 2008 R2. If you do decide to go to this functional level, you gain two features. The first is Authentication Mechanism Assurance. What this allows is compatible services to look at a Kerberos ticket and determine what was used to authenticate the user. For example, if you had a secure document, you may only want people to access it who were authenticated using smart cards. The next feature is automatic SPN management. When you install certain software, you may have been asked to supply a service account. When the software is running, it will use this service account to access resources on the computer. A lot of software will commonly allow you to run the software with a built-in account like the system account. The problem is that when you start using enterprise solutions such as Exchange, you want to isolate Exchange to its own user account to run rather than using an account such as the system account. The service account is like any other Active Directory account in that it has a password that will expire one day. You could tick the box in Active Directory that prevents the password from ever expiring, but this is not very secure in the long term. Automatic SPN management is a system in Windows that takes over the management of passwords for service accounts like these. Automatic SPN management also allows the account to be delegated to other administrators as well. Without a system like this, you would need to create an account to run a particular application, which is common practice. Later on, you may find that the password for this user account changes or the account password expires. When this occurs, the software will no longer be able to run. If this account is linked to your Exchange system, your email could be potentially down until you realize the password has changed or expired. That's it for the domain functional levels. Just for the sake of completeness, if you ever see domain functional levels with mixed or interim in it, these are domains that are in the process of being upgraded from Windows NT 4. If you no longer have any NT domain controllers on your network, then raise your domain functional level to one of the levels that I have mentioned in this video. The last point I want to make about domain functional levels is that once you raise the domain functional level, you cannot go back to the lower domain functional level. For this reason, ensure that you will never add any domain controllers of a lower functional level before you raise the domain functional level. Also, you need to ensure that any down-level domain controllers have been upgraded or removed from the network before you raise the domain functional level. That's a lot of theory. I will now change to my Windows Server 2008 domain controller to demonstrate how to raise the domain functional level. I promise this will be quick. First of all, open Active Directory User and Computers from Administrative Tools under the Start menu. Right-click your domain and select the option Raise Domain Functional Level. Notice at the top, the domain functional level is set to Windows Server 2003. To select a new domain functional level, select the pull-down. In this case, I can choose between Windows Server 2008 and Windows Server 2008 R2. Once I select my domain functional level and press Raise, Windows will give me a warning reminding me this process cannot be reversed. Once I press OK, I will be informed that changes may be delayed until replication has had time to occur between all the domain controllers in my domain. That's it for domain functional levels. In the next video, as you may have already guessed, I will be covering forest functional levels. As always, if you have any questions about the video, please feel free to leave them in the comments below. Once again, thanks for watching our always free videos.